church gets very dark. The stained glass windows are very pretty, but they don't let in.
I want to say welcome to everybody here today. Welcome to Elon Community Church, United Church of Christ. We're so glad to have you here. And if you are on Facebook Live, I hope you're greeting one another or sharing a greeting. And I hope that you will allow time for people to share. That's one of our ways of letting us know we're all here. Also, there's live streaming on our website as well as YouTube later this week. And however you find yourself being a part of us, we're so glad that you are here today. We are in the third Sunday of Advent. We are getting ever closer to Christmas, and we know that there's a lot that's going on. Once again, in the grief department, today would be the day we would do our lessons and carols service. The church would be full of people, and we would then come downstairs for a glorious Christmas dinner. None of that is going to be able to happen today, but we are in Advent season, and so we will continue in an Advent way today. And so I just want you to understand that we're trying what we can to adapt in these days, and these are tough days. But the lessons and carols will go forward, and that is a beautiful service, and it's going to be done virtually. It's going to be on YouTube. It's going to be on Facebook. It's going to be on the live stream on the website. So please look forward to that. We're going to be releasing it the very first thing. It's become our pre-recorded Christmas Eve service, and it's got some beautiful music on it. Our singers from the university have done some songs. We've got different groups that are going to be sharing music, and our bells. It's going to be quite a surprise for you, and it's something that we hope you will take time to be, not only to view, but to enjoy and allow it to fill your heart at this season. And also, I hope that you will share it with others. It's something easy to share. Let people know that it's happening so that we can let everybody share in this wonderful joy of this season. So that being said, there's also going to be one additional thing on actual Christmas Eve, which is December 24th, of course. And that's going to take place at 5:30 in the evening, 5:30 p.m., in our parking lot. We're going to ask you to drive into the parking lot, park your car, and you're going to tune your radio to where our transmitter allows us a frequency. You're going to be able to hear the service. If the weather's as beautiful as it is today, you can bring some chairs and sit right outside of your car, and you'll have we're going to be having music and some sharing of the Christmas story, as well as we're going to light candles together in that outdoor service. It's going to feel like a manger-related service, so I hope that you'll want to be a part of that as well. We will be safe, we'll be distanced, and we'll ask people, of course, as always, to wear masks. So please keep those on your schedules and on your calendar. And I hope the other thing that's on your calendar, if you're an active member of the church, is that we are in the middle of doing a vote. If we were at our Christmas dinner today, you would be voting on the slate of officers. This year, in addition, the council came forward with a simplification in the Constitution to help them function a little more easily. And so they have also put out that amendment to you, as well as our slate of officers. And I just want to say thank you to all the people who've been giving service through boards, committees, officers, all the different people that play a role in the ministry of our church. Some of you on the boards will be rotating. On the committees, some of you are going to be continuing that might not have in the past, because we didn't do anything this year. We weren't able to do our jobs, and so we're hoping that you will willingly continue. If you can't, that's fine. We can always find someone to replace you, but we want you to vote through your deacons. You've probably all, if you are receiving an email through your deacons right now, they're asking you to vote on both that amendment and on the slate of officers so that we can continue into 2021. And if you didn't, you might be receiving something in the mail. That means if you don't have email. And also, finally, just find a way to get to your deacon. The deacons may be also calling you if they can't, if they know you don't have an email, they might possibly call you to see how you vote on this as well. So we know this is a difficult, very different kind of time. So please just go with it and go easy. Let us know that as a congregation, we're doing our best to work together to make these differences. Next Sunday, just to look forward, if you have children, we want to have you take part in our children's party, which is going to be all virtual with Pastor Sharon. And yet there's one part that's not virtual, and that is at 1 p.m. next Sunday, we want you to drive into the church. You're going to drive through under the portico, and we have Santa Claus is going to be waiting for you, and we'll give you a wonderful bag of things that you can have for this year. This is something that would happen another way next week, but we're going to do it this way. So please plan now, 1 p.m. And if you are youth or a parent of a youth, you'll be looking out for an email this week, because their in-person gathering that they had hoped to be able to do is not going to happen. COVID just is not going to allow it. So we have an alternative plan, which we think is pretty exciting. And so be on the lookout for an email, and hopefully you'll be able to respond and know when that is happening as well. So there's lots of announcements, lots going on as we get ready for this wonderful season. I hope now that we can now prepare our hearts and minds for the worship service. So those of you who are here, would you please stand and join me in the call to worship? Those of you who are on screen, you can stand if you'd like to. Sometimes it feels good to stand. That's our way of saying that we are honoring God. And so if you'd like to stand also for the call to worship, you may. But I hope that you have the bulletin, that you can see it as well. Today is the day of joy. Rejoice! The Spirit of God is sending us
to bring good news to the oppressed, to comfort the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
Rejoice! The work of the Spirit is calling us
to rebuild ancient relationships ruined by injustice,
to repair the cities as places of hope, to restore land devastated across generations, to proclaim the year of favor among God's people. Come, let us worship in joy.
Captives will be released and prisoners will be freed. He has sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor has come, and with it the day of God's anger against their enemies. To all who mourn in Israel, he will give beauty for ashes, joy instead of mourning, praise instead of despair, for the Lord has planted them like strong and graceful oaks for his own glory. They will rebuild the ancient ruins, repairing cities long ago destroyed. They will revive them, though they have been empty for many generations.
For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering and make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants will be known and honored among the nations. Everyone will realize that they are a people the Lord has blessed. I am overwhelmed with joy in the Lord my God, for he has dressed me with the clothing of salvation and draped me in a robe of righteousness. I am like a bridegroom in his wedding suit, or a bride with her jewels. Sovereign Lord will show his justice to the nations of the world. Everyone will praise him. His righteousness will be like a garden in early spring, filled with young plants springing up everywhere.
And now we'll light the candles.
Hello?
Sure. You can help me hold the plate. Happy holidays! Can you say happy holidays?
Happy holidays!
God is doing something new and calling us to faithfulness in our context. What are signs of encouragement, of change, of comfort that point to the Holy One at work? Are there signs which call us to join in? Can we amplify these signs in our community? Let us take time to reflect. Holy One, we give you thanks that you meet us in our struggles and call us into a future of hope and joy. You have promised to be faithful, and we open our hearts to you in trust.
In the name of the one you send, Jesus. Amen.
So if the children will gather around, you may be seated in here. The children will gather around at this time around the screen. We're going to talk a little bit about joy, and this was such a great lead-in to just what we did today about reflecting on joy. You know me and my Facebook pages. Well, I'm going to share with you, and she's going to try to, this lovely picture of joy that I found this week. And if those of you there can't see it, it's three toddlers or babies with the letters spelled out, J-O-Y, and they're all crying. How apropos for this year. That is somewhat how we feel sometimes with what we're struggling with this season. So I'm going to ask you children, this, we just lit the candle of joy. What does bring you joy? We just had a time to reflect. What does bring you joy? I have to share a story. After we saw little Eleanor and Penelope and their parents here on the screen, little Eleanor got the Bible and she was pretending to do the reading this week. And part of her reading brought Pastor Randy and I lots of joy because she talked about loving Pastor Randy and Pastor Sharing and her church, and she missed her church and the people at her church. And that brought me so much joy. And I get joy when you guys write me notes or just do things that I get to see where you're lighting your candles or participating in an activity. It brings me so much joy and connects me when I can't see you physically here at the church. So this week, I know that the big joy that you have this week is school's going to be out on Friday, and you get a break from having to do virtual school, those of you that do that. And I know that's going to bring you lots of joy this week, and those parents that are teachers, that's going to bring them lots of joy this week. So there are things in this season that are going to be different, but we need to each and every day look for joy. And so I challenge you this week, maybe if you write down one thing that you're joyful about each day. And that'll be a good way to be reminded to have joy. Let's say a prayer about that. Gracious God, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us. We thank you for those joyful moments in our life. Be with us each day and to remember for us to always rejoice and be joyful. And we say that in Jesus' name, and we all say, Amen.
Well, there's a lot of ways of experiencing joy. And one of the things we're going to learn at this Advent season, that even though we're not being able to do the things that have brought us joy in the past, there are new ways, and there are ways of understanding joy and what that means for us. And we are going to do that by reading our gospel lesson today from the first chapter of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. As we know that this is famously known, this reading from 46 through 55, as the Magnificat, which basically means magnify. It's a way of understanding that Mary is magnifying God as she hears this call, as she has received the call to carry the Christ child. And it's an amazing feeling to know that even in the midst of challenging times, even in the midst of the challenges that we face, we can find joy. Listen now as I read. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. Thus ends our scripture lesson. Let us now be in prayer together. And now, O Lord, let the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, this is probably one of the oddest Sundays for me, because I've never preached in my whole tenure here on this Sunday. This is the first time I've preached on this actual Sunday. This has always been a way of us expressing our joy and our praise by retelling the story of the birth of Christ through the joys but it is joyful, Stephen, that's right. And we usually have the brass here, the cathedral brass. We usually have the bell choirs here. We have children's choirs. We have all these things filling the room. But instead today, we're challenged to be still in Advent. And I'm sure some of you probably went, when we were singing that first hymn, "Where's the Christmas carols?" You know, we haven't sung a Christmas carol yet. We've done Advent carols. O Come, Emmanuel, for some people are considered to be a Christmas carol, yet it's an Advent carol. We've yet to sing a Christmas carol. Well, I'm going to ease your mind. We're going to close our service today with a Christmas carol. So it's going to be, "What Child Is This?" Because, of course, with this being Mary's Sunday, we will share that beautiful song and that Green Sleeves tune, which everyone knows so well. But we've been holding out, trying to help us to see the importance of anticipation, the importance of waiting and expectation. And what does that expectation mean? What does it mean to wait and to anticipate? What does it mean to look forward to?
So often we spend most of our energy just keeping up, not looking forward to. We're usually thinking about all the things that have to take place on that one particular holiday. And you know, when we were on Friday, people were saying, you know, it's only 2 weeks away and it just seems like it's going to zoom right by us. And it usually does. And when Christmas Day comes, it's gone. We go, wow, we did all this work up for this one day. What is it about? We're told that Christ is born in Bethlehem. We're told the wonderful stories of the manger. We're told the stories of the wise men or the magi. We're told the stories of the shepherds in the fields. We're told these over and over again. But today we haven't heard them yet. Today we still hear of the announcing, the bringing forth, the looking forward to. But there's almost a sense of assurance in it, in the sense that when Mary is here, this comes in a story in Luke, unique to Luke, in which Mary goes to see Elizabeth, who will give birth to John the Baptist, who we spoke of last week as also that harbinger of anticipation. Last week when we talked about the abrupt beginning of the Gospel of Mark, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. You know, this is for us on yet another moment of expectation. And in this one, Mary now knows that something is going to take place. She is now gone away because she is pregnant. And yet, in the midst of that moment, she is able to say these incredible words. Words that represent a sense of fulfillment, a sense of joy. And I want to use that word joy and the word blessed in some new ways today. We are really kind of stuck on many ways of seeing joy and being blessed. We think being blessed means you only have the good things in your life. Things are only okay, or they're only great. They're never bad. And that, boy, if you're blessed, that means you don't have to worry about the things like we do. And then likewise, that sense of joy that runs actually so much deeper in our hearts and in our lives and in our souls, something that allows us to feel and to see with a sense of fulfillment, with a sense of a promise that has not only been made but is about to be delivered. That kind of anticipation is exciting. And yet it doesn't promise that everything is going to be okay. In fact, we know that Mary will be promised something that will only bring her pain. She will give birth to a son who will be taken away. You know, I was reading that today and I was thinking about all of the mothers that we have seen on TV screens in these last months and even years. Mothers whose children have been killed abruptly. And I just was trying to capture what it might have been like for Mary. And to call them blessed, at least in our way of thinking, just doesn't fit. So what does good news really mean? What is important in hearing the sense of good news? Number one, there's bad news. There's bad news that needs to be rectified. And in this Magnificat, we hear words that so often get, once again, put into a context that gets lost. This black and white context that says everybody's either good or bad. If you're rich, you're bad. If you're poor, you're good. It seems to be an implication here. If you're on the outside, you're now in. If you're on the in, you're on the outside. Doesn't make sense. That doesn't seem to be the way we hear ultimately a God who has love and compassion, who has mercy for all. But like all anticipation, like all of the words that we've been sharing through Advent, there is also this word judgment. There's a sense of impending judgment. Now that has a little bit of a flair in what we've talked about with the history of Santa Claus, of Saint Nicholas, where we have turned it into a possible threat for children. You know, be good or else. Maybe if you're good, you'll get presents. If you're bad, you won't. Does it stem from this notion that somehow we can only see two-dimensionally? But instead, what we see today in Mary's humble words, a woman who has no right to say these things, in fact, to call her a woman is an amazing fact in and of itself, a woman who is probably so young. To call her a woman would be just something brand new. A world that we're not always recognizing. And yet, who does she visit? She visits a relative, Elizabeth. Elizabeth, who has this child as well, but she is so old, she is shocked that she's going to have a baby. In fact, her husband, Zechariah, is so shocked that he somehow receives the news with a sense of shock and a sense of almost disbelief. And so the angel silences him. On the other hand, we have Mary, young, and yet now pregnant with a new child. And when she hears this shocking news, she receives it faithfully. And she accepts it. And instead of being silenced, she shares these words. These words that are indicative of the words of the Old Testament when Hannah, as a mother, gives birth to Samuel the prophet. These words of promise and fulfillment. Words in which judgment is not the last word. And I want you to hear that today. Judgment does not send you away. In fact, it is judgment that clarifies. It is something we should look forward to. It is something we should celebrate. It is something that should make us joyful that we can be judged so we can recognize what we need to be about and who we need to be. The rich may be sent away empty at this moment, but they are only sent away in judgment to recognize who they are in the world in which we live now. And the poor who have nothing can receive something now, so that as they receive this judgment, they can now come and live in new ways. And the world can be changed. You see, a sense of good news is that there is a rectification. There is a correction. There is a sense of a change that brings something new and allows us to see in new ways and keeps us from living only in broken relationships, in brokenness in the world, and that's the way it is and it will never change. But instead, in our meek, humble attitude, say, God, allow yourself to be in ourselves. Let you, O God, become bigger in this world so that we may understand our way. We may understand what it means to be the people of God, what it means to be a world together, what it means to be in relationship with one another. How that shapes us is really worth the anticipation. Jesus' presence in the world is good news because that change is taking place. It's taking place in God's time. It doesn't take place instantly. It doesn't take place in our time and our impatience in the way we want to have things done. You're going to save those for your Christmas ways, right? Some people are always making sure they're so worried they don't have the right gifts, they don't have the right decorations, they don't have the right things. That's what you need to do. That's fine. But when it comes to our relationships with one another, when it comes to being God's people, this is a message of hope. It's a message of a joy that's resounding and full. It's a message of fulfillment and peace that allows us to move forward. If you don't think you have anything to move forward for, that's when judgment is essential. When you are blinded to anything in the world that's not outside of how you like to have things done, that's when judgment takes place. It is so important for us to always be open to the leading of God, to the leading of being the people God has called us to be, and to understand that those actions will change the world. It will repair the breach. It will build bridges. It will create justice. And that's worth waiting for. It's coming. The good news is near. Amen. We have several joys. We're a joyous group today. We're joyous because we have Christy here with us today, helping us, and we know that our joy is doing some important things right now that she needs to do. She'll be back soon. We have joy because we are working together as a church. We have joy because we have a new tripod, and we are so happy to have the tripod. So now, if you are watching on air, you will not be hearing all these creaks and all these bumps and everything else, and it's so great. We're constantly trying to adapt, trying to update and renew, trying to leave ourselves open to any changes that we need to do as well. It is joyous to know that there are people in our lives, and yet we have to be separated from them, but we know that they are there, and we're finding ways to reach out to them. And I just pray that everyone will be careful as we do that. When I hear about the hungry receiving good things, I think about our Stone Soup ministry and the Feeding the Hungry program that we have here. And as we get a little bit, in just a few moments, you're going to have an opportunity to give a special offering today to the Christmas Fund, helping out those persons who've given their lives and their service to the church and may need a little hand and might need a little extra help. We have boxes and boxes of clothing sitting downstairs ready to be shipped to Honduras this week. And we are so excited and hopeful that those things will make a difference for the people in Honduras. We know that our joy, though, is with those who are not with us. And our joy can be a form of grief. Joy that we have had friends in our lives and people in our lives. And many of you know about our friend Jim, who passed away this week. We showed his obit on our website. And I just want you to know that it's hard when a family has to make a decision to put off a memorial service. So what we did instead, we've asked you to send words of comfort and words of reflection if you knew Jim. Some of you did, some of you weren't able to. But he was 93 years old, and he was a gem. And I just thank you for him. And I say that joyfully. I know that there are concerns that we share, people who have been hospitalized, people who are recovering, people who are near and dear in our hearts. relationships that we are thinking about even now. Situations that we are either worried about or anticipating. Those are part of our prayers today as well. Let's take them all now to prayer. Mary, did you know that all of this would take place? Can we know, even in the midst of this Advent season, all of the things that are yet to unfold, all of the changes that are about to take place? Can we anticipate all that is about to happen? Or, oh God, can we just stay faithful with open hearts and open minds, with a humbleness that your servant Mary shares and allows us to see and feel, knowing that there are new things awaiting, those things that we must adapt to and change, maybe for a short time, maybe for a long time. But we pray, O God, that you will help us through. And we give you thanks that we can come together in community to pray and support our friends, our brothers and sisters in Christ, those people who stretch around the world who celebrate holidays even now like Hanukkah, those who are in our hearts and our minds in relationship. I pray that you will be with all of us, allowing us to feel your presence and to move ever forward. Be with those joys that we have shared and those joys in our heart. Be with the joy that encompasses us. And be with the concerns that we address now. Not only that we have read and know about, but those that we don't know about. Those things that are on our own hearts and weigh down our shoulders. We bring them to you now in this time of silence. We pray these things in the joyous name of Christ, who is coming into the world, who is already here, and who will come again. Let us be in prayer as he taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Yes, it is time to bring forth our gifts and offerings. Also, if you have the opportunity to give online, you'll notice that there is a place called Christmas Fund, and it also says Veterans, Fourth Sunday Special Offering, so that you know that that's the particular place. I know some of you have already been giving to Christmas Cheer and are trying to be able to share with those families in need. There's a lot of ways we can give today, and I just pray that you will be with us now as we share in this time of offering.
Has come to make you new.
this child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod when you kissed your little baby? You kissed the face of God.
These gifts, that help us do your work in this world. May they be used to bring joy, to bring love, to bring need to those who need. Amen.
Just fear for sinners here, The silent word is pleading. Nail spear shall pierce him through. The cross be borne for me, for you. Salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. Raise a song on high, the virgin sings her lullaby. Joy, joy, for Christ is born, the babe, the son.
So go forth this week with joy in your hearts, knowing that the good news unfolds. And now as we go forth knowing what that means. We go forth allowing our hearts and our minds to be wide open once again, preparing and receiving, sharing and giving. As we go forth now, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.